Good evening, speakers and delegates. Myself, Jagdish Chand Joshi, Senior Vice President, McLeod Pharma, welcomes to you all for the mega event on aphthous ulcer management. Our objective of doing this webinar is purely to spread awareness about the management of aphthous ulcer and highlight the role of ribavirin in the treatment of aphthous ulcer. Further, I request Dr. Amit Kamra to invite our esteemed panelists and take the session ahead. Over to Dr. Amit Kamra.
Thank you, sir. Welcome. Good evening, everyone. We thank you for joining in for this session. And it's my pleasure to introduce Saleha. Can we have the slides, please? It's my pleasure to introduce the chairperson for today, Dr. Kaushal Seth. Dr. Kaushal Seth is the National Secretary of AOI. Sir is the past president of AOI Mumbai. Sir is an honorary ENT surgeon at Seth AJP Municipal ENT Hospital. And sir is a consultant ENT surgeon at Axel ENT Hospital. Dr. Kaushal Seth has special interest in endoscopic sinus and robotic obstructive sleep apnea surgeries. I also welcome our speaker, Dr. K.R. Meghnath, who is the director and head of department at Ma ENT Hospitals in Hyderabad. Sir specializes in endoscopic sinus surgery and anterior skull-based surgery. Dr. K.R. Meghnath is a very well-known, internationally renowned ENT surgeon and has mastered the art of endoscopic sinus surgery and anterior skull-based surgery. Sir is the forerunner amongst the best ENT surgeons in India and in Hyderabad, and he has been a mentor surgeon for the cochlear implantation program. Sir has organized innumerable workshops and conferences for propagating the art and science at international, national, as well as regional levels. So we welcome Dr. Meghnath, and our moderator for today is Dr. Vikas Agarwal. Sir is immediate past president at Indian Association of Surgeons for Sleep Apnea. Sir is the first robotic sleep apnea surgeon in India. Currently, sir is the director of specialty ENT hospital at Kandivali East in Mumbai. And as you can see on the slide, sir has innumerable credits in terms of pioneering multiple surgeries. Just to name a few, sir has performed the first robotic base tongue surgery for obstructive sleep apnea in India. And sir has performed the first live robotic based on surgery workshop in the world in the year 2013. Sir discovered the role of salpingopharyngeal fold in lateral collapse in obstructive sleep apnea and classified it as well. With this, I welcome everybody and request Dr. Meghnath sir to take the proceedings further. Sir, you are on mute.
Are you getting my slides?
Yes, sir, visible.
Yeah. So aphthous ulcers are almost, they're always recurrent. And, but most of the times they're self-limiting, but as a physician, we should reduce the morbidity and inconvenience to the patient. Usually they heal spontaneously in around 2 weeks' time. They are classified into major and minor. Minor is more common, 85%, and a rare variety is called herpetiform form, which is around 5%. The minor usually 2 to 5 millimeter diameter, but definitely less than 10 millimeter. A typical feature of the aphthous ulcer is a red halo surrounding the ulcer, which is having a slough, may have a pseudomembrane covering. This is usually a mobile mucosa, non-keratinized mucosa of the oral cavity. The major astaxanthins are more than 10 millimeter diameter. They are more painful, may persist for longer time. Biopsy is required if it is not responding to the treatment and to rule out the other causes of ulcers. Most of the times they heal with scarring. There will be disturbance to the speech and swallowing as well. So already we have seen here the features of these ulcers. The other rarer form is herpetic form. Usually the ulcers will be more, multiple ulcers will be there. The depth is much more deep compared to the minor or major ulcers. But fortunately, they don't form any scarring. Usually they also heal in around 14 days. Usually seen in the females, and they have a irregular contour. Because they converge, they give the appearance of herpetiform ulcers. Usually they are seen on the non-keratinated mucosa of the floor of the mouth and ventral surface of the tongue. So let us see what are the factors which are responsible for these recurrent aphthous ulcers. One is acidic foods, smoking, use of dentures, especially unclean dentures, and in children, horizontal nursing position, deprivation of the sleep, use of excessive fried and spicy foods, high caloric diet, alcohol beyond the limits, and frequent carbonated drinks, and the food colors, additives, and gluten. So if you analyze the etiology, so many etiology has been proposed, but most of the times I think this is of a more of a viral or a autoimmune disorder. The fungi, bacteria, viruses have been proposed. Some tumors, especially the oral squamous cell carcinoma, has been proposed. Some are genetically more susceptible. Maybe they have little low absorption of the vitamins. Anemia is also one of the important factor. The deficiency of vitamins and history of trauma to the mouth. So the differential diagnosis is quite a big list, but the good part is the typical appearance of the aphthous ulcer is a slough around 5 millimeter and a red halo around the ulcer. But that kind of picture is very confirmatory, but however, we have to keep the other causes in our mind, especially if it is long-standing. Like ulcerative colitis, Crohn's disease, also will have ulcers in the mouth. The herpes simplex and zoster. But if you look at the zoster, usually the picture is unilateral, involving a particular area supplied by a particular nerve. Of course, infectious mononucleosis. Another important thing is the hand, foot and mouth disease. It's very common in low socioeconomic group and in children, especially when they start going to the schools. They have lesions over the hand and feet and oral ulcers. So in a child, I always look at the hand and feet whenever a child comes to me with ulcers in the oral cavity. Of course, the HIV infection, the syphilis, ulcerative gingivitis, acute necrotizing ulcerative gingivitis. Of course, we know candida is very common, especially if they are on long-term immunosuppressants. Or another important thing is when they are using the corticosteroid inhalers. After the inhaler, ideally they should wash their mouth. This we have to advise all the patients whoever is on the steroid inhaler. And other malignant diseases also can cause, like oral cavity carcinoma, the non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, the mucocutaneous rheumatic diseases, lupus, Sweet syndrome, reactive arthritis, Magic syndrome, sarcoidosis, bullous and lichenoid dermatosis. And another important thing is the allergic contact stomatitis, drug-induced ulcerative stomatitis, and geographic stomatitis. So what are the treatment modalities we have for the recurrent aphthous ulcers? So topically, we can give local anesthetic and analgesics to relieve the pain and make them have the normal diet. Because a painful ulcers may reduce the dietary intake and lead to further deprivation of the vitamins and the calories. So the local anesthetics have a good role in reducing the pain and keeping their health good. The other thing is antiseptic therapies. Sometimes the pain is secondary to the bacterial invasion, and the antiseptics definitely help to control the infection, and we should not think of prescribing oral antibiotics or systemic antibiotics. Of course, the topical anti-inflammatory agents also will help. Usually, I prescribe the Disprin to be mixed in a glass of water and gargle with that water. That will help very much. Usually, I don't recommend topical corticosteroids, but this is many people use the topical corticosteroid ointment or gel. And some people even give the intranasal corticosteroids. And of course, whenever there is no treatment, we have a herbal treatment readily available. Of course, the immunomodulatory agents are to be considered when the frequency of the ulcers is high. It can be, usually I prescribe immunomodulatory agents if the frequency is once in a month, constitute to 3 months, then I will be prescribing the immunomodulatory agents. The physical therapy is the low energy laser therapy, the silver nitrate 1% application, and ultrasound therapy has been described, but I don't have a personal experience. Coming to the systemic treatment, immune and inflammatory suppression, systemic steroids, immune enhancement drugs, biologics, pentoxifilin, interferon, alpha interferon, methotrexate, and all these are not very useful, but one good drug is ribavirin. And dietary supplementation of vitamins. So, what is more useful is the medical management of recurrent ulcers is the benzodiamine or a lidocaine topical anesthetic as a gargle, a protective bioadhesives, topical corticosteroids, an antiseptic mouthwash, and amlixonox, ribapamide, and systemic corticosteroids. A little more insight into the ribavirin is a mucoprotective drug which was developed in Japan around 2 to 3 decades back. This is an amino acid derivative of 2-quinoline. It has been approved in many Asian countries. It acts by twofold mechanism, preserves the existing cells, replaces the lost cells. It increases the content of the soluble mucus and gastric concentration of PGE2 and PG prostaglandin 1. It downregulates the hydroxy prostaglandin dehydrogenase. It increases the mucosal blood flow through the enhanced nitric oxide synthesis activity. And because of the same, for the same reason, it has been used in the neurological conditions also. It decreases the expression of the neutrophil adhesion molecules, inhibition of the secretion of the TN, tumor necrotizing factor alpha, by inhibiting the synthesis of inflammatory E-selectin. It also has an anti-free radical activity, antioxidant property, and it has a scavenging effect on the reactive oxygen species. It replaces the lost tissue by increasing the expression of epidermal growth factor and epidermal growth factor receptors. This EGF, in fact, this causes angiogenesis, increased production of the granulation tissue, and epithelialization of the ulcer, which will lead to healing. So this makes the ulcer heal fast and give better, faster relief to the patient. Now, this is a safe option, and it is very well tolerated, and improves the, reduces the pain score and the reduces the number of abscesses. So it is very useful in the prevention of recurrent oral abscesses. As I already told, usually my indication is if the ulcers are at least once in a month for a consecutive 2 to 3 months, then I will prescribe the ribazone otic. The administration of ribapamide is not cumbersome. It is no discomfort. It is it can be given as an oral tablet. There are no specific drug reactions with this molecule, and it can be used for long-term treatment. Most of the times I give it for 6 months. I've never seen any adverse side effects. So there are many studies about the role of ribamipide and the other medication. In a multi-center double-blind placebo-controlled study, which was done in 35 patients, and they have received 300 milligrams per day or placebo, and they were given the treatment for 6 months. Yeah, so there is a statistically significant reduction of ulcers by 65%, whereas so the p-value is less than 0.01. The other drug which has been very well used is the Amlixonax. This is an anti-inflammatory and immunomodulator. It's a mucoadhesive. This has been recommended by the American Association of Family Physicians, because this reduces the pain. This is a 5% oral paste. It is to be given 4 times a day. I don't have a personal experience with this because I'm happy with the oral anti-inflammatory gargles and antiseptic gargles. So this ribamipide has been studied in India as well. So we have the data from India as well, and the Manjunath have studied this as a 100 mg 3 times daily for 14 days, and for the basets it was given for 2 months. And minor recurrent after stomatitis and ribamipide has been studied by Prakash. It's a single blind study, placebo controlled. And they have given 300 milligrams per day for 7 days, and they have shown a significant higher efficacy rate versus placebo, and in the form of reduction of the size of the ulcer, reduction in the pain score, and the recurrence of the ulcer as well. This is an important point. By treating the acute attack with the ribavirin, the recurrence rate is much, much less. So the Cork study, they compared the amlexinex and the low-level laser therapy, and they concluded that both are equally good in the reduction of the pain score as well as the healing time. From the third day onwards, the ulcer size has come down significantly, and it is more or less same with the laser as well as the amlexinex. But the advantage of the amlexinex is it is very simple to apply compared to the laser. So in another study, the amlexinex and oral ribavirin have been studied by Pavani, and the conclusion was the combination can lead to a significant pain and ulcer size reduction. So these two can be combined easily. They have an additive effect when used together. So this is about the comparison. In comparison to the Dolo-Gel CT, the Dolo-Gel CT contains choline, salicylate, benzalkonium, and lignocaine. And compared to that, the amlexinex and ribavirin have given a better outcomes. So there's the photographs, what the publication has done. So the synergistic effect of the amlexinex and ribavirin have a more profound effect on the resolution of the pain and erythema, ulcer size, and accelerates the ulcer healing. So ribavirin has a multimodal actions which aid in ulcer healing. Amlexinox is recommended by the American Association of Family Physicians for the aphthous ulcers. The amlexinox alone is at par in efficacy with low-level laser therapy. The accelerated healing will happen with the ribavirin and amlexinox. So we have enough evidence to say that the combination of these two will be helpful in treating the recurrent aphthous ulcers. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Meghnad, sir.
Yeah, I'm stopping the sharing.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Meghnad, sir. It was a wonderful talk with lots of insights into all the aspects of its etiology, diagnosis, and management of these recurrent aphthous ulcers. We all know, however, like when these kind of patients come to us in our clinics, at times it's difficult to treat these recurrent aphthous ulcers patient other than offering them some symptomatic relief. But I feel now with this introduction of ribavirin, we have a strong medicine in our armamentarium to treat these patients. So I am sure all our patients will benefit with this drug. We have our esteemed panelists today, sir, and I think the discussion will benefit all ENTs, dentists, and physicians about the use of this drug in the management of recurrent aphthous ulcers. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Sheth.
Thank you so much, Dr. Meghnath and Dr. Kaushal Sheth. With this, I invite Dr. Vikas Agarwal to moderate the panel discussion.
Thanks, Amit. Thanks for inviting me for this panel discussion. Are you able to hear my voice?
Yes, sir.
Yes, Vikas.
Are you able to see me as well?
Yes.
Okay, so I'll start sharing my slide. Just let me know if you can see it well.
we're able to see your slides.
Very nice.
Yes, yes.
So at the outset, my sincere thanks to the whole team of MacLeod to have invited me here, and the team of MedSpace as well. So we have a very nice panel with us for discussion on recurrent aphthous ulcers. We know that it's a very, very difficult condition, which is being treated by ENTs, physicians, dentists, and some skin specialists as well. And for the panel, we have Dr. Meghnath, a well-known ENT specialist from Hyderabad, one of my teachers as well. Dr. Kaushal is my batchmate and friend from Bombay. Dr. N.K. Soni is a leading physician from Noida. And Dr. Manpreet Kaur is a leading dentist from Delhi. So in fact, she's an oral pathologist and she's heading the Department of Oral Pathology. So as we know that mouth is the gateway to general health and mirror of the well-being. So if we have to gauge the health of a person, we look into his mouth, and the mouth is clean and without any disease. It's a mirror to say that his whole body should be more or less all right. Now, as ENT surgeons, we almost always look into the oral cavity of a patient, because ear, nose and throat is never complete. Examination is never complete without examining the oral cavity. Dr. Mandeep, obviously being a dentist, will only look inside the oral cavity and nowhere else, by and large. My question to Dr. Soni is, sir, how many times you have to look into the oral cavity of patients during the course of examination? Sir, you are on mute. Sir, you have to unmute yourself.
Yes, I think the basic teaching of the clinical medicine is that the clinical examination is the most important part, and the examination of oral cavity and the abdomen. At least our teacher used to say that we should start with the oral cavity. We should always put a hand on the abdomen also, because it is a Pandora box which can give the diagnosis of any illness in most of the times.
So you almost always examine the oral cavity.
That's right. The first thing we do is whenever the patient comes to our OPD, even he starts speaking, we can have the smell and the odor, and of course, we can ask the patient to open the mouth, and if there is any disease process, okay. Clinical examination starts from there.
So Dr. Meghnath had a very, very nice description of the differential diagnosis of the oral ulcers in general, and he showed that how many conditions actually can produce oral ulcer. However, in this panel, we are concentrating only on the non-specific variety, which is the recurrent aphthous ulcer. That means we'll obviously leave away the cancers and all the other specific ulcers. The most common oral mucosal lesion is the aphthous ulcer, which is generally self-limiting and recurrent. That's the problem. If it happens once and goes away in 7 to 14 days, there's no problem. But as Dr. Meghnath also said, that many a time the patient gets it every month. So recurrent aphthous ulcer, for which there is no specific etiology seen, is the point of discussion today. And in the next, say, 30-35 minutes, we'll be limiting our discussion to this particular entity only. So my question to the panelists, I'll start with Dr. Meghnath, the senior most ENT. Sir, how common is aphthous ulcer, not the in general oral ulcers, the aphthous ulcer, excluding the specific ones? How common you would see it in your practice, sir, if you have to give a rough estimate?
I see every alternate day one patient.
Oh, so every alternate day you see one pure aphthous ulcer patient, and your practice is huge, I know that. So Kaushal, how will you put it?
Yeah, I see a couple of them in a week.
Yeah,
definitely, so definitely on the rise.
Very common. And sir, what
lots
is
of part? Reasons for it.
Uh-huh. Soni, sir?
But then in today's pandemic scenario, probably we do not ask the patient to put down his mask even. So what to say of examining the oral cavity?
No, but pre-pandemic.
That's right. Then, of course, we see it quite common. And I think I see at least 5 to 6 patients in a week.
Wow. Dr. Mandeep, madam, you are on mute.
We see about 5 to 7 maybe in a week. And for us, what we have seen in our experience is that a lot of people which claim these ulcers to be as aphthous, we tend to differentiate them further into maybe a traumatic ulcer, or because of maybe a herpetic lesion. So aphthous per se, maybe about 5 to 7 per week only.
But that still is a very, very big number. Yeah. So I think we are dealing with a very, very common condition, and a condition which is extremely painful. People cannot eat, so obviously it's a very, very painful thing. And obviously, Dr. Meghnad showed a very, very nice slide about all the important causes which lead to aphthous ulcer, not the specific one, the non-specific aphthous ulcers. So again, I'll start with Meghnad, sir. Sir, out of all the causes that you mentioned,
yes,
nutritional deficiency, food hypersensitivity, hormones, trauma, drugs, stress. In your practice, you see, say, every alternate day you see a patient. What do you think is the most important reason in them? What do you find as the most important cause?
In my opinion, it's the nutritional deficiency. The next one is the hormonal. And the third one is the lack of sleep.
Oh, so it is that common?
Yeah.
Wow.
I mean, we have seen many patients complaining that their aphthous ulcers are always related to their menstrual cycles.
Okay. So you see them more in females during their cycle period?
Yeah.
Okay. And
it not be during the cycle. It is always related to the cycle.
Right.
They can predict when they are going to get the ulcers.
Oh, very, very nice. Kaushal, what is your take?
Because here I would like to add one more point. You see these aphthous recurrent ulcers specifically in type A personalities, people who are stressful always. I get these kind of patients more. And now actually you will not believe it, in this COVID pandemic, people have been thinking, reading WhatsApp, whatnot, increasing their stress levels. Actually, these are coming up in a big number.
Stress is the biggest.
For me, yeah, type A and stress is the commonest, followed by traumatic ulcers because of a jagged tooth edge or something.
So here I come to Dr. Mandeep. Dr. Mandeep, what do you think? Teeth is the most, trauma is the most important reason?
Many reasons. First, I will just make a little clarification. I am a specialist in oral medicine and radiology. So we are the ones who deal with a lot of these oral lesions, precancerous lesions also. I'm not an oral pathologist. I don't look at this like that's it. Not an issue. Where the etiology is concerned, actually, a lot of the reasons have not been actually been, cause and effect has not been established, where nutritional deficiency is concerned, where trauma is concerned. They are just, even your infectious agents, they've just been hypothesized, but they've not been established as a concrete reason. What has happened in the last 30 years is mostly immune related, like lymphocytotoxicity, mucosal cytokine dysfunction. So, and in some cases, genes which are associated with the pro-inflammatory cytokines, interleukin 1b and 1-6, like what you see in COVID times, cytokine storm. Even that has been postulated. Hereditary, definitely. If the parents are affected, if there's a history, 90% chance that the children are going to be having recurrent aphthous ulcers. If the parents have been a negative history, then maybe a 20% chance. So mostly it is hereditary. And I agree with Dr. Kaushal, mostly we see in people who are undergoing a lot of stress, exam time. Of course, it is more commonly in females because all stress-related things are more common in females. So maybe that one reason, hormonal changes. But exam time, in students, since I'm in a university, so we see a lot of students during exam stress, they come up with aphthous ulcers. If there's a case of trauma, we call it a traumatic ulcer because there is a reason for trauma there. Once you remove the cause of trauma, the ulcer heals. But that's not the case for aphthous. If maybe they're in a case where the mucosa is mobile and is traumatizing that lesion, but it would be an aphthous in the first place and not a traumatic ulcer. So that is a different category by itself.
Soni sir, your take?
Yeah, I think I agree with Dr. Mandeep that traumatic ulcer is a little different from what the aphthous ulcer is. And as a physician, for me, the first two categories are most important. One, that nutritional deficiency. As we know that amoebiasis is a little more endemic in our country. Every other person from every other day is coming with amoebiasis or amoebic colitis. Usually in those patients, the deficiency of vitamins, vitamin B1, B2, B6 is a little more common. They come with oral ulcers, septal ulcers also, along with the symptoms of amoebiasis, and then food sensitivity, and particularly acrod. This is not nuts, more important rather than chocolate and coffee. I have not seen that with chocolate and coffee also people, they get aphthous ulcers, but yes, with nuts more commonly. So for me, nutritional deficiency, amoebiasis associated with, and nuts, these are more common.
Very nice, sir. Thank you very much. How often you see aphthous ulcers, not cancers, with tobacco use? Any of the panelists?
For me?
Fine, sir. Sony, sir.
No. Dr. Meghnath is the first. Yes, you have. He is the senior most. He should come first. No issue.
Sir, don't make me very old, sir.
It's just a number. It's just a number. Don't worry.
So, do you see a lot of tobacco use causing aphthous ulcer also?
No, not much. Not much.
Fine. Dr. Mandeep, do you see tobacco?
Actually, with smoking, the literature, what we read, smoking actually somehow has a protective effect, you know. And a lot of people who give up smoking end up reporting, ulceration.
I'll retract.
Maybe we cannot tell this to the general public. Yeah. Yes. So smoking somehow has a very protective effect. Maybe, you know, because of the smoke, the mucosa reacts by forming a thicker layer, the combustion products, the heat in the oral cavity. So we see an increase in the keratinization of the mucosa because the body does try to heal itself, protect itself.
Very nice.
So that, the ulcers are not there. I mean, the aphthous ulcers. You might find other kinds.
So I put this slide because when people who are using tobacco, when they get ulcer, they come to us, to ENT surgeons, fearing that it is a cancer. And we say that, no, it's not a cancer, but cancer can happen. So you stop.
But it could be. You're absolutely right. Because in these, sometimes the mucosal breakdown, you know, it's a very initial, you know, maybe a carcinoma in situ, a very, you know, a precancerous region. It could be. Definitely it could be. Absolutely right.
You had already covered the topic of the genetic importance. I had put this slide only for that people who are genetically predisposed to having ulcers, definitely they have it more in the families. Anybody, madam has already put across, anybody else would want to say anything about the genetic thing? Any other panelist? So I think it's already covered. Sony sir, you want to add anything to all these conditions that we see, Behçet's disease, HIV? HIV is already less now, but any other autoimmune disorder?
Yes. I feel, yes, quite common that any autoimmune disorder or any immune deficiency syndrome, it predisposes for any infection, even in the oral cavity also. So whenever the patient comes to us with the first symptoms of recurrent aphthous ulcers, of course, we look for the immuno status of the patient, and we sometimes come across which is a hidden disease entity itself and presents with first symptom of recurrent aphthous ulcers. That can give us the clue.
Perfectly. Meghna sir and Kaushal.
I would like to add one point here.
Yes, sir.
In HIV or immune deficiency states, the ulcers are not typical of aphthous ulcer.
Right.
So the ulcers don't have a surrounding red halo, and they are more of irregular, different sizes will be there in the immune deficiency states.
It's a very, very
that kind of one should suspect a immune deficiency syndrome.
Particularly at the dorsum of the tongue, that yes, they get a little more common, which is not with the aphthous ulcers, which aphthous. We get.
Yes, absolutely right, sir. Right. So those things should guide us towards the other investigations.
Perfect. So do you see a lot of antibiotic-induced ulcers, Meghnath, sir?
No.
Ocean?
My answer is no.
Yeah. So people usually who are prone get, to getting... Sorry, sir. Sorry.
Carry on, Kaushal.
No, sir, you carry on. I'll talk to you.
Yeah, antibiotics, they don't have an effect on the oral cavity. Rather, too much of use of nowadays, they're making the drink with the spices and drinking tons and tons during this COVID. Kada, is it Kada?
Kada.
That is causing a lot of ulcers in the mouth.
Wow, so that's
very more than the antibiotics.
Yes,
and the last 1 year, I used to see around 3 to 4 patients a day. I used to tell, if I tell them to not to take Kada, they will be upset. I used to tell them, you have to take it like a medicine, take only 5 ml.
Very nice. Kaushal, what is your take on antibiotics?
Yeah, so,
because I see a lot in my practice.
True. Yeah, see with antibiotics, specifically with amoxicillin or with any antibiotic with clavulanic acid, there's a lot of gastrointestinal upset that we see. A lot of change in the intestinal flora. So that leads to these recurrent aphthous ulcers also. Plus, if the patient has recently taken anti-malarials, that's also a big cause of recurrent aphthous ulcers. This is what I have been...
Sony, sir, you are saying something?
Yeah, I feel that antibiotic overuse of antibiotic or antibiotic-induced gastric upset and then the leading to the deficiency of B vitamins and leading to the development of these ulcers are quite common. And of course, it gives us quite a good idea that we usually ask the patients for the antibiotic history. Even if the patient has stopped it, then we take the history and we come to the conclusion that probably he has overtaken the dosage and because of the abdominal upset, he has developed these ulcers. Quite common.
So I think...
I agree with Sony, sir. And I would just like to add another point where you had mentioned about the autoimmune, especially, you know, with your immune deficiency like HIV. Literature says that recurrent aphthous has been quite, the major aphthous especially has been associated with that. And it becomes so big that now the margins become confluent, get coalesced together. So it is quite common. One of the associated lesions with HIV is recurrent aphthous, definitely. The picture changes, I agree with you. To a certain extent, but then the larger lesions are associated there. And regarding your antibiotic dependence, I agree with sir, because they cause deficiency, you know, because of stomach upsets and everything, that can lead to some sort of ulceration in the oral cavity because the integrity of the mucosa is compromised there.
Correct. So now, Dr. Meghna had already described very nicely that there are a few minor, major and herpetiform types of ulcers. So just in very short, which is the commonest that you see in your practice? Kaushal, which is the commonest that you see? The small ones or the herpetiform ones or major ones?
The small ones. Small ones.
And generally, most of the time, they are self-limiting. But you still see them most commonly. I think everybody sees them as the commonest.
Yeah. The minor is most common. Yes.
So my question to all the panelists is that when you...
But then if you go back, Dr. Vikas, if you go back to that slide... The pictures, pictorial one. Yes, even the third one, with the drug, allergy, with the drug allergy, usually these type of lesions are very, very common.
Okay.
When the patient takes something, say some cephalosporins, if the patient is taking it, as Dr. Seth has said, that with clavulanic acid, if the patient is sensitive, then these type of lesions are quite common and is difficult to treat. These lesions do not go in a day or two, and the patient has to be then treated for a few days, and then it becomes very troublesome, very painful for the patient.
Correct.
I would like to add to that those become then hypersensitivity type of ulcers, then they don't really come in the category of minor. But yes, they must be very common. Sir must be seeing them a lot in his practice.
That's right.
And then category becomes a little different.
Yes.
Correct. So now that we see aphthous ulcers in our clinic, like I have enumerated the important points in the history, family history, and in the examination, obviously everybody knows and we cannot go through all. Any of the panelists would like to add anything specific to be asked in the history, family history, and all these points on the left-hand side so that we can differentiate it from, I think few of sir has already said how to differentiate it from herpes simplex, zoster. So you would like to add anything to the history or examination?
Sonita,
you would like to add, Mandeep ma'am?
And to the history, I would definitely ask if the parents are getting ulcerations, oral ulcerations there definitely. And in the during the medical history part, maybe, you know, we can ask about their loss of appetite or how they're feeling, any, you know, breathlessness. So because people really don't know if they're deficient, but we have to ask about these systems, you know. So youngsters, especially people who are living in hostels. So where we know those are the kind of population which is coming to us, we generally ask about that. So then we can, I always get a baseline CBC with a peripheral blood smear.
Yeah, for all after ulcers.
So that is why that question I definitely asked about their eating dietary habits.
Okay. So you said autoimmune is a very good, yes, Sunny sir?
Yes. As a physician, I would like to take the history of diabetes also, hyperglycemia. Mm-hmm. That is one. Or even thyroid disorder. If the patient is taking any medicine or the patient is hypothyroid or not, these two endocrine disorders also, I would like to have, and then I would like to go ahead.
Dr. Mandeep, you said that autoimmune diseases are very important and common. So for lichen planus, pemphigus type of things, when the presentation is not classic, anything in the history or examination, you would like to differentiate it aphthous from the lichen and the pemphigus?
Yes. You know, aphthous would, in the initial days, aphthous is very painful. They're very small and they are quite distinct, you know. But are you asking me just about the history part or are you asking me along with the examination part?
Everything. You're, go ahead. You're absolutely
okay. Okay. Okay.
And the so, lichen would not be that painful.
Yeah, so like, in fact, in the aphthous, after the first maybe 3-4 days, sometimes the patient has an ulcer, but he has no pain because it is moving towards the healing stage. You know, sometimes they're just not aware also. One definite difference is lichen planus, a symptomatic variety, will have burning sensation.
Burning.
And pemphigus and lichen planus tend to be much more diffuse, much more bigger lesions. They have sometimes pemphigus people, they report with, they'll say that there was a vesicle there or a bulla which ruptured. So you might find a, you know, collapsed membrane there and irregular, ill-defined. And lichen planus can be on the gingiva also. We don't find aphthous on the gingiva. And lichen planus usually has this striae, you know, radiating. So the picture is entirely different from aphthous. So it's very usually easy to make out between these lesions. They're very different.
I am putting this forward, ma'am, because for you it's very easy, but for a routine entry, it's not very easy.
Yes, even for the physicians, yes, you have to make a diagnosis and then.
Is why, you know, I had a question that how do you people handle when you get oral ulcers? Because, you know, so do you refer to a dentist or?
Yeah,
you just prescribe an oral anesthetic and be done with it.
That is a very, very important question. That whenever the patient comes to the ENT person with oral ulcers, probably he will never refer it to the physician for a conservative treatment until and unless, you know, if he has to do the surgery, he'll do it. Otherwise, he won't refer it to the physicians for the systemic treatment because it's easier. The same is true with the physicians also, that if a patient comes first to the physicians, it is relatively easier to treat until and unless there is a recurrence so frequent that the patient complains of the recurrence quite often. Then, of course, we look for the traumatic ulcers and we try to send the patient to the dentist rather than to ENT surgeon until and unless the surgery has to be performed for anything. This is a very frank opinion. Absolutely. At the practical aspect, which I won't share.
So the idea is that it's not what you see. You have to have a lot of history in the background. You have to know the family history and you have to examine the ulcer. And for our ENT colleagues, this is a very important message that the people who are only dealing with the oral cavity, like the dentists who are only and specializing in this oral pathology, they know much more than ENT colleagues because we have a lot of things to look beyond aphthous ulcer. So this slide was mainly for that reason. Okay. Now,
I would always request you all to refer them to an oral medicine specialist so you will get a very good, your patient will be taken care of and come back to you with a lot of smiles and happiness.
Absolutely. So now let me start with you, ma'am, straight away. So now if you have diagnosed a patient as a case of recurrent aphthous ulcer, you will straight away treat or you will still do some investigation because you are very, very clear this is aphthous ulcer. And it is recurrent. Yes. It was there 2 months back also. So will you straight away treat, or you will still do some investigations?
I generally ask the patient if they have a recent blood investigation report, because in our country, if the patient is diabetic or they have a problem, you know, the upper middle class, they are the only ones who are getting regular, you know, medical checkups maybe. So just to rule out any deficiency, or, you know, the most common being our iron deficiency anemia, I always ask for a simple complete blood, you know, count with a peripheral blood smear. I insist on getting my peripheral blood smears to see the picture there.
And what
In the peripheral bloods.
What are you looking
to see
for?
The, you know, any microcytic hypochromic, you know, or the changes in morphology of the cells there. So that being taken care of, we ask the patient that, are you having any problem? Does it cause you any difficulty? Is it too much of a problem? So if you say no, they're fine, they heal within a week, we don't need to medicate them. But, you know, if the patient says no, they persist, or we, and we always tell the patient, if it persists or if it is coming too frequently, because, you know, sometimes people get maybe one episode in a year. But if it comes too frequently, we tell them, do come back to us. So that they, that is when things like amiloxanox.
Not much that you are going to investigate, right?
In the first stage. But if we do find there is an iron deficiency, then we go for serum iron studies further after that. Now, let's say on that count, you know, vitamin B12.
And then probably that is the stage when you should refer the patient to the physician to treat the anemia.
We always do. We don't take chances of vitamin B12 deficiency. We always do, because you never know what underlying causes there might be. We don't want to jeopardize the patient there. True. So that being done, then if the patient says, no, I get very frequent, I get episodes, then we do put them on some sort of immunomodulation. If their ulcer is too painful, you know, things like topical anesthetics are...
I'll come to the treatment part next. Kaushal, would you straight away start the treatment, or you would...
See, a patient
of recurrent... I normally start the treatment straight away.
No. Listen, a patient of recurrent aphthous ulcers coming to me has obviously tried out multiple things in the past. You have to go into the history, what topical medication and all he has applied. So my first priority would be to give him pain-free couple of days.
I'll come to next. Will you do some investigation before
starting? I will straight away start treating and then think of investigation.
And Meghnad sir, I believe you also, all ENTs would straight away start the treatment.
I'll start the treatment, but at the same time, I would like to get the liver function test and a complete blood picture.
So, ma'am has already said that hemoglobin and full blood count with peripheral smear has to be done.
I'll make a little change there. If it's painful, in the sense it's causing him difficulty in speaking or eating, because the mucosa is very mobile, you know, it's always irritating, difficult to talk and swallow. That's when the mucosa is always moving, you know. So, there we always give a topical anesthetic for a day or two to see how he responds. Then we take up the further treatment from there.
Ma'am, any take on this anti-gliadin, anti-endomycial antibodies, or it's only theoretical?
No, I have not come across that at all.
Right. So then we come to the next important point, that if we have done the basic blood profile and the patient has got everything normal and the aphthous is not healing, so when should we do the biopsy? Obviously, if something is not healing, then we need to biopsy. When do you advise a biopsy?
More than 14 days. From 14 days or 3 weeks, for more than 3 weeks if the ulcer has not been healing, then we go for a biopsy. And aphthous generally heals within. Minor generally will definitely heal by 10 days, 2 weeks at the max, you know. Fine. So if it's more than that, persistent ulcers, 3 weeks, then we go for a biopsy.
Dr. Meghnad, when do you decide to biopsy a patient if he is not healing?
Yeah, 14 days, if it doesn't heal, it doesn't show the signs of healing, then I will take a biopsy. If it shows the signs of healing at the end of 14 days, then I will not do the biopsy.
And it will be a punch biopsy or a knife biopsy?
I prefer a total excision and let us get a full understanding of the pathology.
So, under local anesthesia?
Under local anesthesia. Knife
biopsy.
With knife.
Kaushal, what is your take? You do a punch biopsy, knife biopsy?
No, see, if it is aphthous ulcer, purely aphthous ulcer, 15 days, yes, we'll do it. We'll do a biopsy, a knife biopsy. But since we are ENTs, we look at the other buccal mucosa areas also. If you see other suspicions like an erythroplakia or leukoplakia, right at the first instance, I will go ahead and do a biopsy, even if it looks like an aphthous ulcer.
Got it. So, you take the biopsy from the center of the ulcer or from the margin?
A wedge biopsy.
No, from the margin of the ulcer or from the center of the ulcer?
Margin from the ulcer.
Margin of the ulcer. Dr. Mandeep, you want to add anything to the biopsy part? Margin, center?
Yeah, we always take it from the margin with the normal tissue and a bit of the, of course, the affected tissue. And we do, depending on the size, if it's smaller, you can do an excisional biopsy. If it's a bigger lesion, obviously, we'll do an incisional biopsy there.
I'm putting this for the benefit of the junior ENT colleague and the dental colleagues so that they know that what is to be done. Now, we understand that this is a painful condition and the treatment of aphthous ulcers have to be in four parts. First and most important is symptomatic relief. It's painful, so obviously we need to elevate the pain of the patient. So I believe everybody would agree that local lignocaine and systemic painkillers. So my question, I'll start with Dr. Soni. Sir, what kind of pain management do you advise to the patient? It's only local lignocaine application or you want to give some painkillers as well?
Usually I avoid painkillers because sometimes we do not know the patient is sometimes sensitive to the painkillers like ibuprofen and others. So I prefer to give, the local lignocaine and of course, along with folic acid and other supplementation. Okay. So local application of the lignocaine is my preferred treatment rather than systemic painkiller.
Perfectly. Dr. Meghna?
I prefer benzodiamine gargle.
Okay.
That is more simple and...
With lignocaine or only benzodiamine?
Benzodiamine alone.
Only.
I don't use lignocaine.
And that is all
because I'm a little scared of the lignocaine toxicity because of the, if they don't get the relief, they keep on applying the lignocaine. Okay. They may cross the limits.
Okay. Kaushal, what is your take?
I asked them to do 4% lignocaine diluted gargles. Of course, 3 to 4 times a day being the limit, not more than that. Plus, I like to give a lot of probiotics that helps in the healing.
Perfect. And Dr. Mandeep, regarding the pain?
Yeah. Regarding the pain, so, if it's in the area where the patient is going to have a lot of trouble with the tooth interfering, touching it again and again. So, a topical anesthetic, just 5 minutes before meal because, the saliva washes it away. So, the effect doesn't remain for too long. So, just 5 minutes so that it facilitates their eating so that, they don't miss out on their nutrition. And this for a very short term, it helps, And other than that, topical, your amyloxanox paste, that's very good because it forms like a fibrin adhesive there. So, it protects that mucosa from, while movement, so they can talk and swallow and eat. So that is very helpful, especially at night. When the patient wakes up in the morning, the mucosa stuck to the teeth. So when they get up, it's more painful at that time. So we always tell them that you apply a little gel there, a paste there, and sleep so that when you get up, at least it is healed. At night, the oral mucosa, the turnover rate of the cells is about very quick as compared to the skin. So it heals very fast. So if you apply that at night, in the morning, the patient is much relieved.
None of the panelists have to use paracetamol or say ultrasound kind of a thing for severe pain?
No. Always topical. That depends on the size of the lesion and how painful it is. I've never used a paracetamol for systemic. We have never really come across, except for if you're doing immunomodulation, usually topical.
Very nice. So now the second thing would be prevention of secondary infection. So almost everybody will be using antiseptic gargles. So Tony sir, which is your choice of gargle?
Usually I go for hexidine gargles.
Chlorhexidine.
Hexidine. Betadine causes a little scalding and irritation in that ulcerative area.
Dr. Meghna?
Yeah, chlorhexidine.
Dr. Mandeep?
I just tell them to maintain good oral hygiene because any of these mouthwash really causes a lot of burning sensation because it's already exposed. The ulcer has already exposed the underlying area. So it's very painful. So we just tell them topical anesthetics and that fibrin layer and maintain good oral hygiene and maybe diluted, betadine, very, very diluted. So that might help.
Very nice.
That's good enough.
Fine. Then this third thing comes, reduction of inflammation. So many people use local steroid ointments or gels, and some people also use systemic steroids. So I'll start with Soni sir. Do you prefer to apply the local steroids or you give some?
I am a little skeptical about it because my patients, even majority of the patients, they are diabetic also. So usually I try to avoid it. And I give them my patients little reassurance that they should continue with the oral medication and with oral medication and with local lignocaine and chlorhexidine mouthwash. Probably they will get relief in a day or two, but then I try to avoid because it may usually, disturb the glycemic control and then further aggravate the problem.
Dr. Meghna?
I don't use local or systemic steroids. With the above two things, I think we'll get the relief.
Okay, Dr.
Kaushik. I don't use steroids.
I do use deflazacort as the steroid on and off, provided the patient is not diabetic or doesn't have any other systemic conditions where steroids are contraindicated. But local steroids, I do not.
Kenacort or triamcinolone paste is a very, very common thing that people use. In Dr. Mandeep, what is your take on the...
It's the case-to-case basis. I have used steroid where it's extremely painful. The child has an exam, and they want relief. So, in a very selected, very limited cases, I have used triamcinolone with Ora base. It brings down the inflammation, so the person is ready for the next 2-3 days of the healing. So it's very limited, very selected cases, not just randomly. It's not my routine.
So in my practice, I have used it quite often, the Kenacort gel, and it gives very fast relief. So
you're right.
Naturally, if you give it for a day or two to start with, you can actually try. The patient gives a very, very fast relief.
Yeah, because right. probably yes, it reduces this local swelling itself.
Yes.
And that gives the relief in the pain. But then the ulceration doesn't heal with the
local. No, healing part is the fourth one, sir.
It's only
reduction of inflammation and the resulting pain.
That's
Then coming to the final part, all this was symptomatic because pain relief, prevention of secondary infection or reduction of inflammation would not promote the healing. It would take its own sweet 14 days time. So what do we use to promote healing, both local as well as systemic? So I'll possibly start with Meghnad sir because he gave an excellent presentation on the use of both local gel of Emlexanox and remamipide. Sir, so what is your personal experience apart from the studies that you quoted? What is your personal experience in using
I give Ribagen. And for the local part, yes, on few occasions I've applied low dose laser.
Oh, you apply laser. Okay, very nice. Because this study that you quoted says that together a combination of Emlexanox and ribamipide tablet together are actually very, very effective in healing time, reducing ulcer size and all. And so this study, which is a landmark study, and I think a few other studies also you quoted, the doses was 100 milligram orally 3 times a day for 7 to 14 days. We know that the small ulcers are anyway self-limiting within 7 to 14 days. So my question to you, sir, is that did you find it, really beneficial beyond its normal time of healing? Because again, you are giving it for the same time period. Did you really find it exciting?
Yeah, it reduces the duration of the symptoms. Definitely, there is no doubt about it. I've been using it for the last 3-4 years.
Okay.
And the recurrence rate is also negligible. I have not done any study like that, but my gut feeling is that the recurrence rate is very less.
Kaushal, what is your experience?
It does not act immediately. It doesn't act in healing of the ulcers, present ulcers immediately. But in your recurrent patients with recurrent after ulcers, you'll see a decrease in the frequency of the incidents happening. Yes, that's definitely there. I've been using for last 2 years.
2 years. Sony sir, what is your experience?
Yeah, I am using it quite frequently in the last 2-3 years. And I am using the combination, along with folic acid, I use ribamipide also and prebiotic, probiotic along with anti-amoebic drugs. Usually when the patient comes, because I want to clear the oral cavity with anaerobes as well. So naturally, along with chlorhexidine gargles, with the combination of anti-amoebic, prebiotic, probiotic, folic acid, and ribamipide. But then with ribamipide, yes, it is very, very true that the recurrence the intensity as well as the frequency of the ulcerations, it decreases considerably.
Fine, sir. And we know that there are hardly any side effects. So any of you have had any adverse effect with revamipide?
No. I haven't seen.
No.
No.
Partially also.
We didn't see.
No.
There's one study, I think I saw Dr. Mandeep's name. This is another study which shows improvement. Yeah, this study has published in the Indian Journal of ENT, Otolaryngology. Dr. Mandeep, your name is here. Can you tell us about this study? You have compared it with the Dologel CT and this.
Yeah, we did that. So this was done in 2015. This was under an ICMR given for short term studentship for, you know, for the department. And Dr. Shamim was the one of my colleagues who was the principal investigator along with the student in this. So we compared that, you know, the healing is faster with amyloxanox and Rivagen. So we gave it an NG and we did a follow-up. You've seen the picture that's shared over there. So yeah, there was definitely a significant improvement, you know, in the pain and in the quick heal. And there was quick healing in that. So that was very significant. So it does help. You know, people were suffering with more ulcerations, you know, a lot of pain. Everybody has a different pain response, you know. So people who have more pain, and for them, definitely immunomodulation and Revigen and all is a big benefit.
So before this drug was available, because as I understand, Revamipide is not available in India except with the name Revigen by Macleod's. Before this drug was available, the time and the pain factor that your patients were having is certainly being improved upon by this combination, ma'am?
Yes, there is. And before this, we were using the levomizole for immunomodulation. Even that had a good effect, you know, for immunomodulation. Because again, it's all immune mediated, you know, as per the etiology, pathogenesis. So earlier we were using that, but definitely with this, there was a quicker healing. So the time has reduced there.
So it's a very, very clear thing that we should use this combination of both these drugs. Question to Dr. Meghnath. You have been using laser for aphthous ulcer, sir.
Yes.
So this is the paper that it is comparing. I think you quoted this paper or some other paper. Yes. That this paste versus the laser. Have you you got any idea, any study where this paste and the Revigen therapy versus laser, which is faster or which is better, which is more effective, or we should do in combination?
I haven't come across any study. I use the low level laser in troubling cases.
I know you have a acupulse laser. So yeah. At what setting, which power do you use it?
I use it for three watts.
3 watts. And which setting, sir?
Which 3 watts continuous mode.
Okay. Continuous. So you burn away all the granulation tissue which is in the base.
Yeah.
Yeah. Dr. Vikas, if I interfere in between, one question which I would like to ask to Dr. Mandeep, as she did the study on 5% amyloxanox, that I found in the literature that amyloxanox also causes a little reduction in the blood sugar level and a reduction in HbA1c. Have you come across that even in the normoglycemic, this is apart from this, recurrent aphthous ulcers, that it decreases the blood sugar level also in those patients?
So in the study, we had to rule out the patients with medical suspect conditions, you know, for that. So I cannot comment on that right now.
Okay.
We had to have patients who had no systemic history so that we could compare it, you know.
Okay.
So I think it's very clear with the discussion that this combination is useful. Now, this is the last and the final slide. I think everybody had already commented a bit on this before. But since we are in the COVID era and we are seeing a lot of patients which have post-COVID infection. So I'll start with Meghnath, sir. Do you see increased incidence of aphthous ulcers in this era?
I don't see aphthous ulcers, but I see ulcers in the mouth more commonly. As I told, this is all because of the spicy kada.
Okay. Kaushal, what
but I don't see the aphthous ulcers. The typical aphthous ulcers, we don't see.
Fine. Kada induced.
I have seen a lot of ulcers in this COVID era, primarily because of overthinking of these type A personalities.
So I think we should add two categories, Kala-induced ulcer and WhatsApp-induced ulcer.
And this observation should also be sent to the head of the institution where the Kala is being promoted very vigorously. Right.
Correct.
Dr. Soni, are you seeing a lot of FS ulcer increase in this era? Or
yes, we are managing the patients of the COVID as well as in the post-COVID, in our hospital, they are admitted. And these patients, they have developed because of the high use of steroids in these patients. Their blood sugar also goes haywire. They are hyperglycemic most of the time, difficult to control the glycemia, as well as their appetite is a little low. Their nutrition is also one of the major factor. So all these things, they are adding to the problem of ulcers quite common. And along with that, anemia, the iron deficiency anemia and other factors, they are also precipitating. So there are multiple factors which are predisposing factors for the development of ulcers. So we are seeing ulcers also quite common, where we are supplementing with the iron therapy along with the folic acid, along with the ribagen ulcer.
Dr. Mandeep, what is your take? Are you seeing a lot of them?
Right now, the dental, since we work in such close contact with the patient and procedures, we are not doing any elective procedures, So in between, we did open up the institute and we were doing handling, severe pain cases, people who had already been on two rounds of antibiotics and extraction and some very urgent fillings or some openings of root canals. But during that time also, there were a very few ulcers. I'm talking about before this lockdown, the previous time, the last year. And what we did see was an increased incidence in lichen planus-associated ulcers. Stress, again, that is stress-related. And during this time, and we are now shifted mostly to teledentistry. So yes, on the patients send us pictures on WhatsApp and we handle them from there. There have been a very few reports of ulcers. At this time, their main issue is pain. What to do with the tooth pain, which is so unbearable. So we are getting most of those, very few ulcers, not so many. And plus, I'm not associated with a medical hospital where there are inpatients.
Right.
So that again is a disadvantage for me right now. I've not come across this so much.
So I think I must thank all my panelists, Dr. Soni, Dr. Meghnath, Dr. Mandeep and Dr. Kaushal for having an excellent panel on aphthous ulcer. I'm sure I learned a lot and I'm sure my colleagues, ENT, dental physicians, those who are have heard this must have learned a lot. Dr. Soni wants to say something.
Yes, Dr. Vikas, there are some questions in the chat box also, if you take it there.
Yes.
Yes, Dr. Ankit Gupta from Jaipur, he has got put another question. Dr. Naveen Swami.
Okay. All post-COVID treatment, many patients have aphthous ulcer as well as dryness of mouth issues. Why so?
Yes. As I told, that they once we give steroids, there is a development of hyperglycemia. They have got a nasal plank for the nasal oxygen. And so they are breathing from the mouth. So because of the mouth breathing, because of hyperglycemia, these two are major factors where dryness of the mouth occurs so common. And even the oral hygiene is also a little poor. And that is why they develop more often the ulcers in the post-COVID area. Post-COVID.
Dryness of mouth issue. Kaushal, do you think stress could lead to dryness of mouth in these times?
No, not really.
Okay.
Not really. I don't have experience.
Dryness of mouth are because of what? Any of the panelists?
Yes, because I told you, hyperglycemia, that is one.
Okay.
And secondly, once we put in the nasal prong for the internasal oxygen, usually the patient takes breathing from the mouth. And that is also contributes to the dryness of the mouth as well.
Okay, Dr. Manas from Jharkhand, is vitamin B complex supplement effective in the prevention of recurrent aphthous ulcer? So I think this question has already been answered. Definitely it is effective. Mr. Govind,
because I would like to...
Sure, sir.
Yeah. About the long COVID.
Yes.
Is also one of the cause for the dryness in the mouth, dryness, pain, sore throat, all this...
Sir, mainly,
reacting in the long
mainly,
COVID.
Yes, mainly it occurs because there is an stuffiness of the nose. Because, more commonly the patient now they are coming up with the mucor also, because the stuffiness of the nose, usually they become mouth breather most of the time. And then once the oxygen, oxygen therapy is reduced, then with the mask, they are not able to, tolerate the mask so conveniently, rather than the nasal prong is a little more comfortable for them. Now, if we put in both the nostril, we put in the nasal prong, then it becomes difficult to take a breath through the nose. And so, even in the longer duration, whenever even we are reducing the oxygen therapy, even then, because of the mouth breathing, the dryness of the mouth occurs so often, more common.
Dr. Mandeep, there's a question from Dr. Govind Singh Rajpurohit from Bikaner. He's asking, is Rivagen, does it has a role in oral mucositis induced by cancer chemotherapy or radiation? Do you have any experience on that? Dr. Mandeep?
Not really, but Rivagen having an antioxidant effect, maybe during the healing phase of the patient, maybe you can give it. Although there is a contraindication, you know, with cancer and antioxidant, because it can cause increase in the cancer cells also. It's a difficult call. And at that time, it's mostly topical management, debridement, because, you know, the other system is so much affected that you just look at the topical management and symptomatic relief for the patient so that it can eat at that point. And may I please add to the dryness of the mouth to what we were having discussion earlier? I have seen in some patients who did not have any nasal intubation, nothing of the sort. They were at home, they had very mild symptoms. Even those patients reported dryness of the mouth. So probably like your anosmia and, you know, loss of taste. This is probably also an effect at the COVID time. People did report dryness of the mouth, some itchiness, some rashes, you know, on the skin, something like that, which did go away after some time. Of course, with what Sony sir has mentioned with the intubation and nasal oxygen, definitely there is dryness of the mouth or the nose being stuffed. They do tend to breathe to the mouth. So that does happen. But other than that, even in the very mild symptoms, people have reported the dryness of the mouth, which I think should resolve, you know, as the patient improves.
My question is that does this drug also help somehow in reducing the the taste part of the COVID patients that we are having? The loss of taste is there. Does Rivagen help in that, also improving something?
We're all discovering every time this new therapy is coming out regarding COVID itself. So maybe you can try it, sir, in your this thing. Yes. Give Rivagen and see if it is antioxidant and it is causing, some things come out of a discussion.
Most of the time we have to treat these patients out of the box. And
Coronal might help, sir.
Yes.
okay, fine. So we have a question from Dr. Shyama from Odisha. Role of systemic steroids in recurrent aphthous ulcers. So we have already seen that it's not well proven. Some people use it, some people do not use it. And her other question is that if the patient is using any PPI, can Rivagen be added? So I don't think there's any contraindication of using Rivagen if the patient is using any PPI. Dr. Mandeep, any contraindication according to you?
Not really. I mean, if the patient is suffering a lot, then sometimes, I mean, I've really not given systemic corticosteroids to any patient, like I told
PPI. We very frequently use PPI along with the Rivagen also. We do not see any side effects. Yes.
It can be. Kenneth from Karnataka, he wants to know when to suspect autoimmunity dysregulation in a patient with aphthous ulcer. So, Dr. Soni, you are the right person to answer. When to suspect autoimmunity dysregulation?
Usually, whenever the patient comes with the other symptoms also associated with aphthous ulcers, like the patient is having severe anemia and the polyarthralgia or any other disease process symptom, systemic symptoms, which indicates towards the, and then we have to, investigate the patients for that, the pernicious anemia along with the other factors, and the investigations for the autoimmune, which gives us a little more, and the recurrence of the ulcers is a little more important. The frequency, if it is more, we have to look for it.
And basically, if you do not get a diagnosis, a small biopsy will go a long way in clinching what is the problem. Dr. Jayaprakash from Kerala, he has seen aphthous ulcer running in families which responds to steroids, but when it recurs, rivapamide, is it effective in such cases? I think we've already answered that in recurrence. Yes. Dr. Meghnath has already said the recurrence rate drops down a lot. Dr. Shambhu from Assam is asking about the role of probiotics. So obviously there's a role of probiotics in aphthous ulcer, which are associated with antibiotic abuse or antibiotic associated. Dr. Vikram from Mumbai, duration of therapy is 7 to 14 days. We have already answered. And traumatic ulcer in the mouth, Dr. Mandeep, traumatic ulcers, do you give Amalox and Ribogen combination?
Traumatic ulcer means there is something which is causing irritation and has given a trauma that causes ulcer. Maybe it's a sharp tooth, maybe it's a jagged edge of a denture base or some wire poking, or maybe somebody's fallen down and hurt someplace, so there is a traumatic ulcer there. If it's a sharp tooth, we round it off depending on the reason, And for the time being, till it heals, we can give a topical, like Amiloxanox or a topical anesthetic or an aura base, which is neutral to facilitate the healing there. And with regard to the previous question, if I may just add to the autoimmune, spectrum. So there, the intraoral examination will always tell you autoimmune, basically, the lesion that we see most commonly is lichen planus. That there's some immune response there, which has even pemphigus also, right? So an intraoral examination. So I would definitely recommend you to refer the patient to an oral medicine specialist who can differentiate and who can take it further from there. So you are, you manage the patient better from there. I would definitely suggest that.
Perfectly. All right. So this question about the traumatic ulcer thing was from Dr. Amit Arora from Hisar. So Dr. Arora, this is the answer, that till the time the cause of trauma has to be removed, you can use it. Dr. Praveen Bhatia from Delhi and many others are asking about, is the cause nutrition deficiency or especially B-complex deficiency more important? What about giving long-term B12 in recurrent aphthous ulcer? So Dr. Mandeep, I think you can answer this question.
So, like I mentioned that nutritional deficiency has not really been established as a cause. You can say that it may be a contributing factor to the mucosa breaking down, but actually it is immune mediated, So, if there is a definite deficiency, obviously you will give vitamin B12 if the case demands, But other than that, we would recommend definitely going from some sort of immunomodulation. You can give Ribogen and, that would help. So along with vitamin B12, when the deficiency has been taken care of, evaluate the patient again. And if required, then add something else to that.
Right. Dr. Soni, this is the question for you from very senior ENT surgeon from Dhule, Dr. Jagtap, Charivas Jagtap, is asking relationship of GI disturbance and ulcers in the oral cavity.
Yes, definitely it is there, which I said that as amoebiasis is very endemic in our country, and every other person is, and then the GI disturbances causes little disturbance in the GI flora and deficiency of B12 vitamins. So naturally, the correction of the GI disturbances along with the supplementation of folic acid and Ribogen along with the chlorhexidine mouthwash, probably this helps to reduce the frequency as well as the intensity of the ulcerations.
And another question is from very senior doctor of ENT, Dr. Madhu Mangal from Imphal. I have been to his place, wonderful Imphal Medical College. He's asking, we have seen many cases during menstrual period. Any relationship of aphthous ulcer with female hormones? I think Dr. Meghnath answered this, na?
Yeah.
Relationship to...
Yes, yes.
Dr. Meghnath, can you again elaborate, Dr. Madhu Mangal?
Yeah, the deficiency of estrogen during certain periods of the menstrual cycles... they will have the increased incidence of aphthous ulcers. Is it hormonal or stress related is not clear.
Any other panelists want to add on that?
Again, there might be an increase in maybe because of stress, but as such, it has been postulated, it could be, but it has not been definitely established there.
And the last question is Dr. Arvind from Rajasthan. When is biopsy indicated? So I think we have already established that if the ulcer does not heal for 2 to 3 weeks, then the biopsy is indicated. So this is around 5:24 and we are almost at the end of our allotted time. So I think I will say a sincere thanks to all our panelists and hand the session back to Dr. Amit. Dr. Amit Kamra?
Yes, thank you so much for the enlightening discussion, and indeed it was a learning experience for all of us as well, and I'm sure that the audience has benefited immensely from this, and this will go a long way in transforming patient care in India. Jagdish sir would like to
I would say what a nice session, almost A to Z about the aphthous ulcer, its management, treatment, everything was very well and clearly defined by all the eminent panelists are concerned. Even a non-medical person like me have been benefited a lot as far as your deliberation discussion is concerned. And I'm sure all the delegates and the number of delegates are around 1,800. They have participated over here, so they must have been benefited with the knowledge you have shared regarding aphthous ulcer is concerned. On behalf of the Macleod, I really thank all of you from core of my heart for participating, guiding, supporting, discussing all about the aphthous ulcer is concerned. Thank you to all of you for your participation, all the eminent panelists are concerned. To all of you and delegates, I will request try our Rivagen. In fact, Rivagen is the only brand of Ribamipide available in the domestic market. And then along with the Lexanox, that's our brand of Amlexanox, that holds almost 85% market share is concerned. Okay, thank you so much to all of you. Thanks once again.
Thank you very much for giving us the platform. Macleod's particularly giving us the platform to interact with all the colleagues there from Bombay, from Delhi, and from everywhere, from Hyderabad. Thank you very much once again.
It's our pleasure.
I second that, Sonu sir. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Vikas. Wonderfully conducted.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Vikas.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Joshi. Thanks, Dr. Sonu. Dr. Meghnad.
For a while, Dr. Meghnad, I'll call you personally.
Dr. Vikas, Dr. Kaushal Sheth, and Dr. Mandeep Kaur, all of you all, thank you so much. Thanks, Samit.
Thanks,
Mr. Pradeep.
Thank you, ma'am, and thank you. Thank you to all the panelists.
Have a great evening ahead, all of you.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, everybody. Yeah, once again.
Thank you, sir. It was awesome, sir. Awesome.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sony, sir.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you.